My guest today is Melissa Perry, CEO of Products Labs, a consultancy that advises companies on becoming product-led organizations. Melissa's focus is on software products, but I think the ideas here translate much more broadly. Today we'll be discussing products, product management, and Melissa's book, Escaping the Build Trap, How Effective Product Management Creates Real Value. Melissa, welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
So the core insight in the build trap, my words, tell me if you agree with them, is that companies focus on the wrong metrics when evaluating their own performance. So what are they measuring, and why is it appealing to them to measure things like this? So it seems to me that there must be somebody who wants to fall into the build trap. Otherwise, nobody would fall into the build trap.
Yeah, I think what really happens is that as you scale companies, right, like when you start off as a startup, you're going, what problem am I solving? How do I create value for my users? And you're really focused on value. And you can't survive if you're not. Honestly, they go out of business really fast.
Right.
As you scale and you get more money, right, you've got a longer runway. And this pressure to deliver really, you know, gets on you. And it goes all the way up until you become a corporation, right? So now it's not like, in corporations, it's not survival mode. It's more of like ship, 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 so we can deliver more value. And what happens is these organizations start to think about quantity, right? Like how much are we shipping instead of like quality and what value are we actually providing? So we get this misconception that the more products we ship, the more software we put out there in the world, the more value that we're actually providing, but that's not actually true.
Where's the original sin? So one of the things we talked about just before we started the recording the conversation was that there is definitely a difference in finance circles, mm-hmm. right? In their perception of what's going on in software companies. They're different disciplines, yet the finance people come to own a lot of software
yeah.
organizations and software development processes. Is it just that you have let's call it a plurality of views of how to run a company, mm-hmm. and maybe the wrong people are influencing the wrong decisions? Is that kind of as simple as that?
I think that's very true of where it is right now. But I think so. If you look at it, like the very large corporations that were that are making these digital transformations, they call them these days, you've got companies that were not originally software based, right? They've been around for hundreds of years,
right.
40 years, 50 years, right? Software was never how they scaled. Instead, they scaled through services and through people to deliver the financial products or the insurance products or whatever you sell, right? And at its core, what they sell is not actually software,
yeah.
right? It's a credit card. It's a car insurance, right? It's these different things that are not actually software. If you look at Google, like what they sell is actually software, right? It's based in that. So it's about these two companies coming, these two types of companies, right? Software-based and non-software-based, coming up in different times and different ways. And the companies that were not software-based are realizing that they can't keep up with the ones that are software-based and innovating on top of them because they can scale so much better and so much faster to get delivery of value out to customers through software.
Mm.
So now they're going, oh, if we want to compete, if we want to be innovative, right? Like the whole world lives online now, right? Like you've got your phone in your pocket and that's how you want to manage your credit card, right? You don't go to banks anymore. Like everybody wants to live on the internet. So if these corporations want to like keep up with that, they have to figure out how to innovate through software.
Mm.
And I think that's really where it is today.
You know, one thing that came to mind as you were talking there was how similar the pitfall is, which is there something inherently distracting about software?
Mm-hmm.
So think about it this way. So you're saying there that organizations are used to delivering value to customers without software, right? They aren't software companies. But one of the really important observations I think that you made in the book is that even software companies aren't really software companies,
yeah.
right? The whole point of your intellectual framework here is that you're not focusing on the software, you should focus on the value,
yeah.
which is something that I suppose these enterprises lose sight of
mm-hmm.
when software wanders into their view.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. It's like, you know, Google doesn't sell software. They sell like the ability to search,
yes.
right? It's the value
yes.
that you get at the end of the day. It's the method that they deliver that in is through software. And that's why it scales really nicely for them.
Mm-hmm. So what should a software company measure?
It should really be measuring the value and the outcomes that help drive the business. So when you think about any kind of organization, right, there's customer value and there's business value. And what really drives business value is delivering the customer value. So the business value, right? That's making money. It's
some ways easy to measure.
Yeah.
Are you making money?
Exactly.
Do you have revenue?
Are you growing, right? Are you saving costs, right? Like that's also an important part of it.
Yeah.
So those
for your
are,
clients, you mean, or yourselves?
For yourselves too,
yep,
right?
Okay.
So that's how you scale your business.
Yeah.
So they should be measuring things like that, right? Which is good. And a lot of them do measure those things. But it's the trick is like connecting that back down into what do the teams actually do on a day-to-day basis. And that's where they fail. So a lot of places will go, oh, well, we shipped 20 features last quarter. So we're doing really, really well.
We can measure that.
Yeah, we can measure that.
We can have it up on a spreadsheet.
Super 20, easy.
Big number.
Yep. It's like, just count them, right? Like that's, it's so easy to measure. And then you go, okay, so what did those 20 features do?
Right.
Right? Did they make more money? Do you have more people signing up? Do you have like less people leaving? Which are all the things that actually drive a business. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times they can't really pull back those outcomes into those features that they ship. Mm-hmm. And that's because they're focusing more on shipping than actually what does shipping those features actually do.
How do you measure that? Because this seems to be a very, very difficult problem, right? And the reason why I think you backslide into this build trap is that they, whatever management of the organization can't figure out how to measure anything else other than features shipped.
Yeah.
You've consulted with these companies. What do you suggest they do?
Yeah. So it's not so hard to measure them, right?
Okay.
So a lot of times it'll be difficult to make a one-to-one, you know, prediction. And there's a lot of bets that you actually have to do in software when you're building anything, right?
Yep.
Like if you're going to launch a new product, even if it's not a software product, you got to take a little bit of a bet.
Mm-hmm.
And what you have to do is gather all the data that's possible that you can get to show you that it's lower risk, right? Like show you that you're on the right path, you've lowered your risk by gathering these data, and that this thing is pretty likely to result in what you think it will result in.
Yep.
So
you're making a prediction.
Yeah, you're making
a prediction.
You're
saying, here's what I think is going to happen.
Yeah.
Right.
And then what you do is you test it, right?
Yeah.
So then you put it out there and then you measure it and you make sure. And if it's not going the right way, then you iterate on it.
Mm.
So what organizations typically don't do at scale, which makes it hard to measure these things, is that they don't have a systematic approach to connecting those top line business metrics or bottom line business metrics, doesn't matter, but down to what the teams are doing.
Mm-hmm.
So they're not going like, I believe if we launch this feature or we create this new business line or we do that, it will result in these outcomes for the business. They're
mm-hmm.
not really connecting it there, and they don't take that all the way down into the teams. So for example, if you have like a team that's shipping, you know, a dashboard for users, like what do you think that dashboard is going to result in? Do you think it's going to drive them to take more actions in your platform? If it drives them to take more actions in the platform, what does that result in? Do you think that they will, you know, are you creating revenue through the actions that they're taking? Are you retaining them because they're using the platform better and they're getting more value for it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like what do those things actually relate to at the end of the day? And you can measure those with different methods, right? Like there's quantitative methods that you can look at to really pull in, are people using it? So you've got, you know, products that are coming out like Amplitude and Pendo that show you people are actually using things and taking the steps that they want to in your product.
Using the software,
right?
Hmm.
So that's telling you like if people are using it or not.
Hmm.
Then you can go do follow up with the qualitative research of do people actually get value from this?
Hmm.
People are already measuring retention in these companies. Like how long do people stay with us? Do they leave? Right? You can start to measure that and see, you know, are people tending to leave sooner than we thought after we release something? Are people churning? Right? All these metrics go into really making a healthy ecosystem of the right products that we're building.
Mm.
And those are the things we should be measuring, making our decisions off of. It just takes a little bit more effort to actually measure those than did we actually ship something.
Yeah. As I was reading the book and thinking about this, I was trying to figure out what's the common denominator amongst all products.
Mm-hmm.
And features is an interesting hypothesis, possibility for that, right?
Okay.
So you can measure it, and every product has features, has more features.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just, you know, the link gets broken here, but presuming for a second, the more features, the better the product. Or rather, put it differently, the more features that are used, the better the product,
mm-hmm.
right? And so the skip there is between usage and not. And so maybe the kind of atomic unit of value in software is people's attention.
Yeah.
Are people paying attention to this feature and using this feature?
Mm-hmm.
And that, if there's a way to aggregate that and kind of roll that up, am I on the right track there?
I think so. So it's the way that I kind of look at it, you have different features inside the products. Now, a feature may not be packageable and sellable in and of itself.
Yeah.
So that's why we have products. So features are part of a bigger product, right?
Yeah.
So if I were to sell you like a keyboard, right, on your phone, that's not enough for you to do anything, right? The phone itself is the whole product, right? That's what makes it valuable. So you have to package that and put it out there. You can release different features that will enhance the value of the overall product, but the features themselves won't be able to stand alone,
mm-hmm.
you know, without the wrapper of bringing them all together.
Mm-hmm.
So it's together in the right combination of that solution that makes it really valuable for the product. Now, it is, we measure the health of products by looking at Definitely usage, but usage is a leading indicator that people are actually paying attention to your product, which is right.
Yep.
Right. But then what I look at is how many people are actually coming into our product, and then how long do they stay with us, right? Yep. And the retention part, I think, is the gold mine of most products, right? Unless you are, you know, I'm trying to even think of like an example of a company where you don't want people to actually stay with you. Yeah, like you can do...
In some ways, how about your organization? So this is weird, right? But your job is to train leaders and then release them into the wild.
That's true,
Right? So you don't want return customers. That means it didn't work.
Yeah, we want them to come back for like things that they might need later. But if we've done our job well, we want you to be running really, really well. So we are designed... Yeah, I guess we're a good example. It's like we want you to come back for different things, but if you're coming back for the same thing over and over again...
That's a problem.
Yeah. So like that is definitely, that's a good one for consulting. I think for some products, right, it's not about, sometimes we get into a misconception of attention versus time, right? This comes up a lot. For example, if you have like a very utility software, for example, DMV, okay. Renew your license, right? Yep. You want somebody to be able to renew their license in 5 minutes, right? And be done with it. You don't want them to spend 20 hours on the site. And a lot of times people will like look at how much time people spend on their products instead of can they accomplish the thing that they want to do.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So less is more in that
less
case.
Less is definitely more. For anything that's like a workflow app or a utility app that's like in and out, I just want to accomplish my task and move on.
Yeah. One of the, I think the part of the book that I found most interesting was embedding kind of these observations about concentrating on customer value and the difficulty of integrating that into a whole org structure of a company, right? So how does, let's call it a senior level executive know that their teams are, and obviously over longer time spans, revenue's going up, somebody's profitable, that's great, we got that. But so let's say you got a board meeting or whatever, a recorder, and they're asking me how you're doing.
Yeah.
What did they say?
Yeah, so.
Where do they point to?
This is a big thing that we've been doing with a lot of the companies that we work with, and we call it product operations.
Okay.
And I've done a lot of large scale transformations in corporations, and this seems to be the missing link. Like we go in and we train all our people on how to do things. We get the leaders, you know, the leadership stuff, we'll put the strategy in, but then nobody's actually measuring it and looking at the progress, right?
Yeah.
So when we think about product operations, there's a bunch to it, but there's one key piece that's called data and insights that we do. And what we do is we go and we pull all the stuff that people are doing together and talk about the outcomes and put it into dashboards so that leaders can look at it and say, oh, okay, so last year, you know, or this year, this was the strategy for the company. These were our big objectives that we really wanted to hit. I call them strategic intents. And the strategic intents in our strategy framework are very much like business focused objectives, like, you know, return to a growth stage company or increase our margins to like 80%. You know, it's very tactically focused. It could be also, we want to, you know, enter a new adjacent market that will increase our margins or like, you know, help grow us, stuff like that. So it's very big business decisions, usually market facing, different customer segments, you know.
Something the finance guys can understand.
Exactly, something the finance guys. So if you tell that to any leadership team, they'll be like, yes, that's what we want to do, right? Or this is how we want to differentiate ourselves from competition, right?
Yep.
Like very focused high level there. Then the next level underneath that is called initiatives. So that's where we start, we look at the strategic intents and then we say, okay, let's say that we want to go into this new market to start to diversify, you know, where we sell, and we want to, you know, grow our business, and it leads to revenue growth. How do we do that through the software we have? Do we have to create completely new software and platform? Can we repurpose some of the stuff we have? We just have to like fine tune it for this different group. And those become the product initiatives. So they're higher level goals that we want to hit and things that we want to accomplish in order to reach those strategic intents. So now we're connecting the business down to what do we actually have to do to get it done. And then the teams break that down even further into something more tactical and more short term. That's like, okay, if we want to increase that, if we want to accomplish that product initiative, right, we're going to have to do X, Y, and Z to build out the software and release it. And that should get us there.
Mm-hmm.
So then each level of that strategy has different goals that are associated with it. So you probably have leading indicators, which is what I call goals that will show you that you're getting to the higher level goals. Like you can't really measure the revenue until you launch it, right? That might be 6 months out.
Yep.
But there's leading indicators that show that you're on the right path, right? You can have a beta test. You can get adoption in the beta test. You can measure people doing retention on it, right? Which means like you just release it to a smaller segment of people and make sure that they like it, right? Mm-hmm. So you can do all these things shorter term, faster, to show that the bigger goals are on track.
Mm-hmm.
And what we do in product operations is we go about and connect all those activities together so that you can look as a leader at it and say, okay, we are on track to launch into this new market. We've shown that through beta tests, you know, we've adopted, 500 people adopt it. They come back frequently. They're retained with us. We've gone out and done research with them. They're very, very happy with it. They want more. They want to sign up more people. They want to sign up more stuff, right? And that's showing that we are on track to reach these goals. So it's about like really connecting it through the organization and rolling up the stuff we're doing with the teams into revenue and cost matrices on top, so that the leaders can look at it and start to make decisions, right?
So what does a company do before reading your book, before setting up a product operations team? Just as an aside, as I'm listening to it, the thing that's coming to mind for me is, boy, it's complicated. There's a variety of metrics you have to pay attention to. You have to invent ones and then measure them and then communicate them back up again, right? So there's a very intensive amount of work to do there. And of course, you are suggesting that organizations should have an entire group of staff dedicated to only that. So that makes a lot of sense. Matching resource to need there. What does a company do without that? Is it just the count features? Is it simple as that? Or is there, what, when you walk into an organization you consult for, what do you tend to see?
I see a lot of bad things. If it's a very large corporation, what they typically do is silo off technology into its own department.
Right.
Sometimes that's under like a digital transformation office, or it's under an IT office, or it's just kind of hanging out over there. Right. Yeah. Like it's over there. And then the business is over here. And I asked them, like, how do you plan your strategy? And they're like, well, the business plans a strategy, and then they just tell us what to build.
Mm.
Right. And that's almost always what happens.
Yes.
It's 99% of the cases that I see.
Yep.
And what's happening is those corporations are not thinking of software as a strategy, right? They're not seeing it as a way to deliver more value and tie it into the business. Like the way I think about all those corporations, right, that, you know, we're not software based and have these financial instruments or these insurance instruments or whatever you sell, right, is that software is a wrapper around it that helps you deliver that solution in a better scalable way.
Yep.
Right. So it's easier to deliver value to your customers. You can now do things you couldn't do before with humans with it, right? Having AI in there to predict what people do, make it a better product, position it better for people, make it easier to access your account, make you pay your bills, right? Like you can now surround each one of those products with a lot of technology that helps deliver value and produce value more for it. But when corporations separate that, they don't see that, right? They look at it as, oh, like this product is, you know, the business, it's the product that we sell, and software is just a way that, you know, we can, you know, plug in and ship it or sell it easier, right? They're like, well, I will just sell it this way. And they don't connect the strategies of the two, and they don't think about them as the same thing.
So let's say the first call they make isn't to you, to a different consultant who walks up and says, Agile can solve your problem, right? So let's get these integrated teams together. Maybe describe it a bit about what that kind of advice might sound like and what your criticism is of it.
Yeah, this is something that's happening everywhere right now.
Everywhere.
Like, Agile transformations, since I started consulting about 5 years ago, and before that I saw this too, but Agile transformations were all the rage. And it was to get, what Agile does at its core is basically helps connect the business and technology, right, into teams, right, but it's very team focused, it's not organization focused.
Right.
So the whole premise was, we're gonna bring people from the business into the teams with the developers so that they can iterate faster through the product, understand the requirements better, and ship things faster, right, that will actually satisfy the customer.
These are Scrum teams. With the
Scrum teams.
Right.
Well, it doesn't really matter. So, like, Scrum is just a flavor of Agile.
Okay.
There's also, like, extreme programming, too. So, Scrum is the predominant thing that everybody uses.
Okay.
So, a lot of times people think Scrum, Agile, same thing. It's not. But Agile is more of a philosophy.
Yes.
And a way of working that's about bringing the business and technology together. And
yes.
I don't think that's opposed to anything that we do with product management.
Right.
But if you look at how people practice Agile and the different flavors that came out of it, Scrum, XP, and like that, it's very tactical about how do we get the work done.
Yeah.
And it's very focused on development. And
shipping features.
Shipping features, right? And it's about the roles that you play in that team to bring people together.
Yep.
It's not about how are we building the right thing.
Yeah.
How do we ensure that we're building the right thing? It's got very little to do with business strategy, technology strategy in the way that it enhances it. It's very much about how do we get our work done in a faster way. So when people go through agile transformations, right, what they do is they fix all the teams, but they don't fix the system in which the teams live. So it's still, you get the same thing at the end of the day, right? Like, you might be shipping features faster, but you're not connecting the good work that those teams are doing back up into the business strategy. And that's why agile transformations are like going agile, right? It's just not enough. The philosophies in the organization are good, right? Like, what they bring to the organization about getting value out faster to customers, satisfying the customer more, bringing business and technology together, all those things are great. In practice, people don't make the full transition. They go, you know, oh, okay, all of our software teams now have like a product owner on it. We're done. And that's not really what's needed, right? You need to connect all the things that you do from the business down into how do you deliver it through technology.
There's a one interpretation of that whole framework. And at the beginning, maybe it was, I don't know, some part in your book, I was feeling a similar sentiment, which was the knowledge of the customer lies with the bottom rung of the organization, like the customer-facing portion of it. And that kind of feedback is incredibly valuable. Now, what's interesting to me about your, call it evolution of the framework, is that actually the people at the top do have value too.
Yeah.
Right? And so the organization is something more than a bunch of disembodied scrum teams or whatever the team names are, who are close to the customer, they're able to build the features, but there is an integrating component which is necessary still, which can get overlooked. So what value does the strategic intent give to the teams? If they can talk to the customer and say, if the customer wants this, I understand what they want, I'm going to build it, who else needs to be involved and why?
Yeah, so what strategic frameworks provide is direction. And this is the biggest gap that people get into when they think about autonomous teams. So Agile does promote autonomous teams. I think autonomous teams are good.
Yep.
The problem is they don't give them any kind of direction. So when you give, I've been to companies that have 4,000 scrum teams.
Wow.
If you let 4,000 scrum teams all individually and never consulting with anybody else make up their mind about what to build, you're not going to have a holistic company, right? Like, they're going to build everything.
Yep.
So when we think about autonomy with teams, it's not that they just decide everything on what to build. It's more about you give them enough direction to send everybody in the right direction. And at the leadership levels, you have to make that choice, right? And every time I come into work with the C-suite of these, like, these organizations, even these big ones, I say, where do you want to be, right? Like, what's the plan for this? You've been doing the same thing for 40, 50 years, right? Like, what's the next phase? And the next phase can't just be, oh, we're going to be digital, right? That's not a vision. How are you going to compete with these companies that are coming up out of startup mode and taking a lot of market share from you, right? Like, they don't scare them right now because they have a lot of money, but give it 10 years, give it 20 years. Like, people are going to be searching for something that is easier for them, that really matches them better. And these companies can innovate faster because they're smaller, they're more focused, and they have very good direction. So corporations need to put that direction in. And that doesn't mean that, you know, we are all only working on one thing with 5,000 scrum teams. It means that we're balancing a portfolio that can look after the stuff that we actually have going on that are doing well, right? So maintain what we currently have. Take that and start to differentiate a little bit with it, build new products on top of it, and then innovate, right? Build things that we will get us to the next 7 years, 10 years, right, in the future. So we're actually exploring that. And that's what Amazon does really, really well. Amazon doesn't do a million things well. They don't have a great corporate culture, but they do really do portfolio management super, super well. And that's where you get things like Alexa, right? Because they're looking at how do we differentiate ourselves? How do we innovate, right? And they make a point to have teams that go out and explore those different areas, and they test and they learn. So leadership has to make the decision that they're going to invest there, right? So they're in charge of setting, like, you know, the vision for where the company is going to be. Are we going to keep doing what we're doing? Are we going to, you know, go in a different path? How are we going to, what kind of path do we really want to take as a corporation, right? Like, why are we here? Why do we show up to work every day? What's the value we're actually going to produce here? And then what they have to do is start to think about how do they want to invest in that plan, right? So do they want to spend 60% of the budget that they have maintaining products and 40% looking at new innovation? Are they doing 80% to maintain the current products? Most of the companies that I see in these corporations, 100% of the money doesn't really go to innovate. Like, it goes to maintaining what they already have. Nobody's looking at innovation. Nobody's figuring out how to pull that in. Or they'll set up like little startup teams that are kind of like separate, and nobody really figures out how to integrate them into the strategy, right?
So I think that one of the main vehicles for integration often in bigger companies is the budgeting process.
Yes, exactly.
And you think about what is ultimately the source of control for the senior management organization is that they got the money.
Yep.
And they can give you the money, and they can choose to give you more or less money.
Yep.
And you have some interesting ideas on budgeting. And I wonder if you could talk a bit about what you think an improved philosophy of budgeting could look like for a larger organization. Because if they're not telling somebody exactly what to do with the budget number attached mm-hmm. to it, now they're saying, you guys, as long as you're satisfying these objectives, go figure it out.
Yeah.
It's hard to put a number to that.
Yes.
So how should they think about that?
Yeah, like to me, if you push this back into goals, yeah. right, what happens is we typically fund teams at the lowest level. We fund projects. So most of the accounting in corporations is done on like a project basis.
Yep.
So there's usually a project management office. People have to come and put like together an entire business plan about what they're going to build and why they're going to build it. I've seen those things get made in like a day. I'm like, how could you possibly like know that you're going to spend $20 million on this thing and that's going to go exactly to plan and you just came up with a strategy in a day?
Like, because I had to. I had no choice.
To. That's what they say. And I don't blame the people who do that. That's just a product of, mm-hmm. you know, the way that
the system.
The system, right? So then they bring all the business plans together and then they're like, okay, we'll fund that. We won't fund that. We will fund that. And then they fund it very much into the deliverables, right? You build me this feature, it costs me $30 million, go, right? Like that. So the problem is, it's pretty unknown. They're usually not tied to goals. We don't really know what we don't know. So
yes.
if you haven't tested it with users yet, how do you know that's even what they want?
Right.
So we're making guesses. So a lot of budgeting processes are made off of guesses.
Well, you have two ways you can work on that, right? So one, you pad it,
mm-hmm.
right? And say, I know there's an error of margin here, and so let's just sandbag this sucker.
Oh, yeah.
Or you go massively over budget.
Yeah, so,
or one over both at the same time.
And I had, so at one financial institution, I knew the CTO, and it was a very large corporation. He actually started as like a director of engineering and he worked his way up to being the CTO of Europe and Americas because he was so mad at the budgeting process.
Hmm.
And what he found was that his team would get relegated, you know, a couple million dollars to build something. And they would realize that they don't need all that money to actually build it. But the problem is if they didn't spend all that money that year, they would never get that much money again.
Hmm.
Right? They only look at what people spent in the past to figure out how to budget
yeah.
for the future.
Yeah, what do we do next year? What do we do last year?
Exactly.
I've seen it.
Yeah, and so they're like, well, we could have saved $5 million this year, right, of our project because it just didn't take that much money.
Yep.
So, let's do that. And they're like, oh, no, let's just go spend that $5 million building a bunch of random stuff just so we can get $5 million next year, too.
Yeah.
This happens everywhere. And what should be happening, though, is more of it's breaking them up into systems of, first of all, is this in discovery mode or delivery mode, right? So we're looking at that for looking at the different projects and the initiatives that we're doing. Instead of funding the projects that we're doing, fund the product, right? So if you are in a credit card division of a company, right, and you are looking at the travel notifications or the notification products, the fraud department, right? Like, what are you going to give the fraud department in the credit cards, right? Like, what can we improve there? What's there? And we have to get ahead of that strategy before budgeting season actually does begin and come back with a plan in that fraud department that's like, okay, here's some questions we need to explore, but we're not sure if we should actually build a product from it. That's
yep.
discovery mode.
Yep.
So we want to give those teams some funding, right? Like a little bit of funding so that they can go prove if that's something that we should actually be doing. Then there's things that we're like, we know we need to build this because we have all this data and we've actually approved it. Those ones you can say, okay, let's take this funding and do it. But if you fund it at a higher level, right? If you say like, oh, we're going to give, you know, the fraud department, you know, $20 million this year. Now you can change course a little bit in the different projects and the teams as you go, because you can start to see if it's working or not, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if that discovery mode gets into delivery mode, you're like, okay, have a couple more people go.
Mm-hmm.
And instead we do it by project. So if that project fails or if that project is not the right thing to do, we have to keep going with it instead of funding it by products.
Mm-hmm.
And Agile does promote stable teams as well, right? So you have stable teams around the product and you're putting them around the product and they own that. And when you do that, instead of funding people by projects, you get one, better delivery because people know how to work together. There's some known knowns in there. They've refined their process. Like they're really good at, they know the product better too, right? So they can work a lot faster. And you keep people in those teams, right? Of course you mix and match a little bit to give people variety, but like you relatively keep those stable around the products and then you fund those products. And then the person who is usually like the director of product or the VP of product, let's say, and the VP of engineering, right? They get together and they start to figure out how do we relegate this money, right? How do we delegate it into the rest of our teams, right? To fund these projects.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a big thing going on right now about like innovation accounting, Janice Fraser has done a bunch of work with that. I saw everybody on Twitter trying to get her to write a book on it, because this is one of the biggest questions. And I think a lot of companies have all these questions about like CapEx versus OpEx. Yeah. How do we do that?
Because you could run out, right? Let's say you see this many projects, discovery projects. Mm-hmm. And I do want to talk about that, because I think there's a lot of interesting things to say about that. But if they all turn up green, then it's like, well, kind of out of cash.
Yeah.
could happen.
And then that comes down to prioritization, right? What should we build now versus later? So it's not about funding everything. I think we look at organizations and we're like, we must fund everything. That comes down to prioritization, right? Yeah. And that's what leaders do. So the leadership, when we look at prioritize, what's more important to do now versus later?
Yes.
So I honestly think sometimes I think organizations too have so much money that they have to spend, right? That they do everything. And they're better off if they did less. Mm. Honestly, I will say that. Like, they're probably better off if they did less, because some of the decisions they make to spend that money are not the right decisions. Or they just look at, like, how do we spend this cash as fast as possible?
Yeah.
And that's a really good problem to have. I wish I had that problem.
Yeah, it's like, tell me about it.
Yeah, but it still is, you know, you get into this habit of doing everything instead of just what's the focus and what's the right thing. And then you lack focus around the company. And that's what I see is like the enemy of everybody's strategy. Like, if you go into these corporations, you ask everybody what you're doing and why, you get a million different answers from all over. And then that's where you don't see the product of the products being shipped that are actually going to drive revenue, right? Or lower costs.
And that is the value of leadership, right? Mm-hmm. So back to the question of what are agile teams missing? I think that big picture leadership might be a way of encapsulating the answer. I think we're running out of time here, getting close to it. But I wanted to talk a bit about, I think we have a few more minutes. So I wanted to talk about product management itself.
Yeah.
Right? Because it's an important part of the book. And the way I want to get in there is to talk about your definition of a minimum viable product. Maybe talk a bit about kind of a general conception of what that might sound like and your refinement of that term.
Yeah. So the way that I think about minimum viable products really comes from more of a lean startup mentality.
Right.
And that's really where I learned it. And the minimum viable product was basically the smallest amount of effort that you could do to learn.
Right.
So that might take many different shapes and forms over the course of validating your product. It could be starting with like, you know, a survey, or starting with, you know, a prototype of something, right? Experiment. I love experiments. Different ones like concierge. But it's basically how do you deliver the value and get some feedback that you're on the right path. Mm-hmm. And as you work up to really testing all your hypotheses earlier, then you start to turn it into code, right? Yeah. And then it's about the smallest shippable product that you can actually get that's in software. But the beginning part of it can be all different ways to test and learn, right? So it's in the process of really testing and learning and getting there. Most people think of a minimum viable product as like, what is the smallest set of features that I can build to ship out a product?
Yeah.
That's a late stage MVP to me. Yeah. Because you still can do many different things to learn from your customers. You can, and I think I see companies do this actually all the time. Like, they don't realize that they're doing this, but many, many companies will want to release a new product out there, but they just can't build all the software in time. So what do? They hire a bunch of people. Right, so they'll open offices in India for people to process all the documents or do the faxing, right? All things that they want to automate one day, but they hire a bunch of people to do it in the meantime while they figure out how to scale or validate that or do the software. To me, that's an MVP, right? And it doesn't mean that an MVP is like super cheap, it costs a dollar, right? You're gonna have to invest money into doing that, but what it allows you to do is iterate quickly, and you're not investing like, you know, $500 billion in building this product and then finding out that it's
not good.
With
long lead time.
Yeah, it's a long lead time. So you can start delivering value immediately, learning about it, right? And then you start to automate things away. Mm-hmm. And I see a lot of corporations do that by nature. They just don't realize that they're doing that. And what they do is they never get to automation, right? Mm-hmm. They never actually get to the software pieces of how do we automate this? How do we make this faster? How do we make it streamlined? And that's usually the enemy of where they fail.
So talk about testing.
Yeah.
So testing is such an interesting concept. And I think maybe the deepest, most underappreciated idea in all of this, I think, is that you learn by doing.
Yep.
Right? You don't, and what's even more amazing is something that was really cool you talked about in the book, which was even the customers don't know what they want. Right?
Yep.
And so you have to pull that out of them. You know, mm-hmm. that's the art, I guess, of project management. So talk to me a bit about that. What makes a good product manager? How do you learn to do that? And what is testing?
Yeah, so testing to me is really figuring out what your customers want in small ways. So that could be, you know, showing them a prototyping and their feedback on it. It could be building something super, super small and like letting them use it, right? And getting some feedback there. It's about making a hypothesis about what you think it will do and then really checking that and making sure that it does that. So it's like, we believe that by, you know, building this workflow for users, they will accomplish your tasks 10 times faster, right? Yeah. And then that will produce value for the business because, you know, they don't have to hire 50 more people to do these things, right?
Yeah.
How do we go test it? How do we make sure people really enjoy it though and it is helping them? So maybe we set up an experiment where we're saying, you know, the way that we want to make these workflows faster is that we can take away a lot of this manual work and automate it on the back end. So that's where we might have a couple people do the work for the people on the back end, right?
Yeah.
They don't see it. They just think that everything's being automated. It says, okay, like your process has been kicked off to the back end.
Yeah.
It'll be ready in, you know, you say it's slow software, it'll be ready in a day or something like that, right? People will do it and it'll come back and it's like, okay, they can move on to the next task, right? And then you go back and you can measure it and see if it did produce value for the customers, if it made their lives easier, if it did things better, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's like, that's what product managers should be thinking about, right? Like, how do I make sure that this is actually valuable for my users? How do I get the feedback from them? How do I make sure that whatever we're building is going to produce the things that I think it should be building from a business perspective and from a customer value perspective?
Yeah, and that seemed to be a very unique ability
mm-hmm.
to be able to integrate those or be a generalist
yeah.
across these domains. Talk about good product management. Like, how do you find
yeah.
these people? Where do you get them?
I will say it's hard. Like, it's not something that you learn in school. And I do a ton of hiring of product leadership, CPOs and VPs of product for the companies that we work with, but also like senior product managers. So we try to help all the companies that we work with get the right talent in. That's a big piece because we don't want to be there forever. We're like, you got to hire people.
Yes.
Hire these people and let them do their jobs. And so when I go out and when I interview people, it's really interesting, I would say too, because like 10 years ago, when you found people who had product manager on their resume, they were usually really, really good product managers. And they came out of software companies and they did some of this testing and learning and there were fewer of them on the market. And then since Agile kind of took over, and this became a really, really hot job. Like it's blown up. It's been one of the higher paying jobs over developers
mm-hmm.
recently.
Sure.
And there's just not a lot of people in the market. So it's super competitive. Like when we find people, they could be gone in a day. Like this happens every day
yeah.
to me. but a lot of people, one, have been changing their titles to product managers and they were not necessarily product managers
okay,
before.
Yeah.
I see that a lot. And it's fine if you did the work. Like
yeah, sure.
I was actually
if
called.
You were.
Yeah. So like I was called a business analyst when I was at Capital IQ, but like I did the work of a
yes.
product manager. And,
yes.
you know, when I went to JP Morgan, I was a business analyst there, very, very different. I was like, oh, this is not what I was taught at Capital IQ. So that was, you know, if you have that and you have the experience, I look at people, what people actually do. I rarely look at titles because of that, right?
Mm.
I'm looking for people who go out, talk to the customers, figure out what they want, work with teams to figure out how to iterate that and test it and ship it. And then go back and measure the success of their product and grow that into a business strategy, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what I look for in people. How do people learn that? Right now, there's not a lot of paths. There's a lot of companies and in schools that are teaching courses on it. So a lot of times people get into it from going to get an MBA. I don't think that's necessarily the right path. It depends on what the school is for sure. And there are some MBA schools that do product management teaching better than others. But then there's other ones that don't really have product in their curriculums. They just have, you know, MBAs. And that's where you're really learning how to optimize a business, not necessarily how to build software.
Mm-hmm.
But people come from like all different backgrounds. And I think you have to start building a product, right? So I tell people who want to transition, like build your own website, build
yeah.
your own product, experiment
sure.
with it, right? Like go out and just try something, right? Build a prototype. If you come to me and you've never done this before and I could see that you spun up your own little project that was like, you know, better dog food and you went out and you interviewed users and you came up with a strategy and you figured out how you were going to do it, even if you didn't ship it, like to me that shows me you put in the work and you start to logically think through those things. So I tell people that when they don't have the experience. I see people come in from development and UX and from the business who learn how to work with development better. To me, those types of backgrounds don't matter. What matters is that you're curious, you ask a ton of questions, right? You will push back with data on people. A lot of people I see that don't successfully aren't successful in product management, they take whatever is given to them and they just run with it. Mm. And when I ask them, like, did you push back or did you come back to your boss with data? They're like, no, I couldn't do that. So a lot of places they don't feel empowered to do that, but people won't even take the initiative. And a lot of product managers that I've trained who've been successful with that, they've said like, oh, I'm worried that, you know, I can't push back, but I want to try. Can you help me like formulate a plan on what to do? And I'm like, yeah, so let's give this a shot, right? Like, come back with these reasons, go get this data or whatever. I had one person who worked at a bank. She went through one of our trainings and then she came back to me and said, hey, I think I'm building the wrong thing, but I'm really worried about telling my boss because I might lose my job. And I said, I said, have a conversation, right? Like, let's just show him with data what's going on. And she told her boss, she stood up and she said that. And she's like, I just think this isn't what we should be spending our money on. I think we might be able to do something else. And he said, you're right. And she got promoted.
Cool.
And she now runs like a very huge part of that business because she had the power to go back and stand up. And, you know, she didn't come back and say like, you're wrong. This is all the wrong stuff. Right. Yeah. She just said, I think we could be doing something better. Why don't we collaborate on it and try to figure that out? Mm-hmm. So you need to have like that confidence and that ability to really like synthesize the data, make a plan, come back with an argument and really present that. Like that's kind of what I look for in product managers. So there's ways to get started. Like we have an online course called Product Institute, which is usually for people who are already in a company where they might be able to practice. It's not as much for career transitioners. Career transitioners, there are places like General Assembly that will give you like a very good introduction to what's going on there. We've had like people in our class from, you know, UX backgrounds or from development backgrounds or business backgrounds that want to learn more about it and been successful there. But this is a big problem. This is a problem that I'm personally trying to solve is the education of product managers and something that we're really putting a lot of work into this year to come up with like what makes a good product manager, how to train them and get into it.
The world needs a lot more of them.
And that's it. It's just that we need a lot more of them. It's going to be a bigger job. It's going to be a more important job. And companies look at this job and they think that it's just tech, right? They go, oh, product is tech. And that's not wrong. That's wrong. Product is business, right? Yeah. It's about helping you scale your business through making the right moves for the value in your customers. And more businesses need to see that that's what this role is. It's a business function. It's going to help you grow your business. And it's going to do it in scalable ways and with the right solutions for your user. And we need more people who can think like that.
So I want to close on actually touching on really the magnitude of this, because at the beginning of the conversation or near the beginning, you talked about how really this is about two sides, let's call it a legacy enterprise organization that has the business side, the tech side, and you gotta find a way to merge them in some ways. And I think that the product management people, you could use the words business analyst, the role you had, which is product management. And that's familiar to me as well, where we have, let's say, buying a new billing system for your company or some equivalent, right? And it's an internal software project. You talk about internal tools in the book for a little bit. And that is a situation where you need a business analyst, a product manager, more than anywhere else. Let me talk a bit about how that translates. It is universal, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so too. It's the, it's pretty universal. I think it depends on what they're doing. So like I said, JP Morgan, when I was a business analyst, I was not doing product management. Like I was kind of managing the disaster recovery of servers. It wasn't product management. But but if you look at like what people are doing in these large corporations, there's a lot of business analysts that are now becoming product managers. It's still, it's not a one-to-one transition. You still have to learn a lot of, going out and talking to the customers, bringing that back in, iterating, testing and learning, right? Those types of things, strategic moves on those areas, but it's not a bad domain to get into. But I think that's really where all these organizations are moving. I will say too, from an organization standpoint, when you have really good product managers, you can scale your teams better. You don't need, 20,000 people sometimes to run an area of the business. Sometimes you need 50, right? So there's going to be this shift, I think, as we get better product managers and as we get better, people who are really good at building software like this, where these companies are going to be able to produce more, right, with less, because we're going to be streamlining a lot of those functions. So I think that's going to be something that's going to be really interesting over the years to come, to see like what's going to happen to these places that have 45,000 people. Either you're going to spin up a lot new products, which will be really cool, or is it going to slim down?
Yeah. My guest today is Melissa Perry. Melissa, thank you very much.
Thank you.